here in this room, from famous to less famous but equally important speakers. So you're part of a long tradition here. The University YMCA is celebrating its 150th year this year. Last Friday, if you were here, you were here for what was our really our Founders' Day. The inception of the Y was February 3rd, 150 years ago. So really welcome for being to be here in part of a wonderful long tradition. So thanks, Michelle, for being here. I'll pass it over to you.
First of all, thank you all so much for coming out and joining us today at this Friday forum. I am really excited to be here with this particular group of people. I'm going to have the pleasure of introducing them to you and then giving them some time to talk about their work in the world around art, healing, and justice. The really cool thing about being with like really smart people and people that have been doing this work for a little while is that I don't have to be smart and I can just let them be smart. The discomforting thing about being with really smart people is, you know, when you're not the smartest person in the room, it can be a little awkward. But these are some of my growing heroes in this work for a very long time. Some of them are very new to campus and some are not. This conversation, Art, Healing, and Justice, is a small part of some work that we are doing at Krannert Center. And we have two other conversations by this title scheduled. One of those conversations, or the other two conversations, revolve around a piece of theater that is called Jabari Dreams of Freedom that Krannert Center is presenting February 22nd through the 25th. And Jabari Dreams of Freedom is a small play written by a playwright named Nambi Kelly from Chicago. And she wrote that play for her nephew, who happens to be a student now at the University of Illinois. But she wrote that play when her nephew learned of the murder of Trayvon Martin. And she wrote that play using her art as a way to speak to her nephew about the value of his life, and to also offer some way of valuing Black lives in particular in that case. And so those other two conversations, Art, Healing, and Justice, One is scheduled for Thursday, February 23rd at 5:30 at Krannert Center. And the other is a conversation with a group of teenagers that's scheduled for February 25th at 11:30 in the morning. But this is sort of, this conversation here was evoked by thinking about the role that art can play both in healing and in justice. So I'm going to try very quickly to read through these introductions. I'm going to start with Miss Angela Rivers because I don't have a written bio for her. So, okay, thank you. Angela is an artist, educator, historian, and museum professional. I know her mama, so I would have said this is Mrs. Rivers' daughter. She spent over 35 years teaching, supervising, managerial, and consulting positions in museums and in the cultural arts arena in Texas, Central Illinois, and the Chicago area. Her experiences include the DuSable Museum of African American History in Chicago, Illinois, the Chicago History Museum, the Field Museum of Natural History, Chicago, Illinois, the Art Institute of Chicago, the Dallas Museum of Fine Arts in Dallas, Texas, and teaching African and African American art at Eastern Illinois University. She was artist and project coordinator for the mural, The Pictorial History of African Americans in Champaign County, that formerly graced a building at Park and Fifth Street. And that's how I know Angela. When I came to town some nearly 40 years ago, that mural sat on Fifth and Park, and I used to see it every day when I went to work. She's a graduate of the Champaign school system. Her family has been in Champaign County since after the Civil War. Amazing history. Her longtime interest in researching her extended family lineage with a historical framework which dates back to the mid-17th century Virginia. A perfect segue into the Champaign County African American History Project, which she will talk about a little bit. She holds a BFA in painting from the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, and a Certificate of Arts Administration from the University of Illinois, Springfield. She's done postgraduate work in art education and art history at Southern Methodist University and Eastern Illinois University, respectively. In 2017, she and Barbara Suggs Mason consulted on and appeared in the documentary A Home of Their Own, a documentary on the lack of housing for African Americans at University of Illinois through the 1950s, one of many collaborations over the years. Miss Angela Rivers. Alexandra Barbier is an artist, educator, and performance maker whose practices emerge from dance, performance arts, blackness, and queerness. Her works and teaching promote whimsy, humor, and playfulness while also inspiring critical thought and cultural societal commentary and inquiry. Her current praxis engages black vernacular dance forms, especially those connected to queer identity and South Louisiana heritage. In the fall of 2022, she was awarded NCC Akron's Community Commissioning Residency and recently presented her research at the International Association of Blacks in Dance Conference and Festival in Toronto. Alexandra is currently a postdoc research associate in the dance department at UIUC. Please welcome Alex. And in this case, we get a twofer. Christopher Robert Jones and Liza Sylvestre are artists and writers based in Illinois. They are research assistant professors at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, where they co-founded CRIP, Cripistemology and the Arts, a transdisciplinary initiative housed within the College of Fine and Applied Arts. They are also co-founders of Cripping FAA, a project designed to disseminate Crip principles through the 11 units in the College of Fine and Applied Arts via co-teaching collaborations with professors in each of those units to discover and design new Crip-centric approaches to teaching within our college's discipline. They have exhibited and performed at locations such as Weissman Art Museum, John Hazard Gallery, Gallery 400, Krannert Art Museum, the Whitney Museum, and the List Visual Arts Center at MIT. Their institutional work is supported by an Andrew W. Mellon Foundation grant and Arts Core grant from the Office of the Vice Chancellor of Research and Innovation, a presidential initiative expanding the impact of the arts and humanities, and a call to address racism and social injustice research program funded by the Office of the Vice Chancellor for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. Please welcome Christopher and Liza. Please. Starting to feel like I'm in church. My voice is starting to change a little bit. And last, my brother from another mother, Lou Turner, is a clinical assistant professor in the Department of Urban and Regional Planning at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, and a former academic advisor for the Department of African American Studies from 2008 to 2017. Lou was research and public policy director for Chicago's Southside Community Organization Developing Communities Project from 2000 to 2014. Developing Communities Project is the Southside Community Organization formerly led by Barack Obama. He is a board member of the African American Leadership and Policy Institute. Professor Turner is the principal investigator for Hal Barron Digital Archival Research and Publication Project at UIUC, a colleague of the late Hegelian Marxist philosopher Rhea Dunayevskaya. He has written extensively on Fanonian, Marxonian, Hegelian dialectics. A comrade of the late worker editor Charles Denby, Turner was managing editor of the Marxist humanist newspaper News and Letters from 1989 to 2000. With Dr. Helen Neville, Turner co-edited Franz Fanon's Psychotherapeutic Approaches to Clinical Work, Practicing Internationally with Marginalized Communities. Lou Turner is co-author of Franz Fanon, Soweto, and American Black Thought, 1978-1986, which circulated in the anti-apartheid underground of the Black Consciousness Movement in South Africa. In 2021, Lou Turner developed an asynchronous online course, Black Arts Today, FAA 201, if you're interested in taking class, for the College of Fine and Applied Arts, and he authored a Black Arts e-text as one of three digital platforms used in the course. Please welcome Lou Turner. So Ann and I have agreed that each of these people should at some point have their own much more time to talk about their work here for you. But I'm very happy to have them here. And our plan today is for each of them to take somewhere between 7 and 10 minutes to introduce themselves, who they are, what they do, and to talk about art. I'm especially interested in talking about art and movement work, Black liberation work, Crip theory work, queer studies work. Who would like to get us started? So talk a little bit about yourself, about your work, and then maybe an especially interesting project that you're working on. You know what, Lou, do you mind?
Yeah.
See if that's on.
I'll unmask for this.
I don't think, it's not on.
It's not on.
I probably turned it off. Here.
Might have gone to sleep on.
Do that one. That one's on.
Thanks. Again, my name is Lou Turner. I'm a clinical assistant professor over at the Department of Urban and Regional Planning. My work is, the course that I teach is on community engagement in planning. And as Sam mentioned, I also created and teach a course on Black arts. Today, one of the platforms that this course operates on, I'd like to talk a little bit about, because I know we have very little time, is the e-text for the course, which I wrote and with contributions by the Dean of the College of Fine and Applied Arts, Dean Kevin Hamilton. One of the aspects of the e-text, which is there's a lot going on, it's very engaging with students, is that we created 14 mini documentaries with me writing scripts and interviewing faculty who are also artists in the College of Fine and Applied Arts, Black faculty or faculty who deal with Black arts in some way. We did 14 of these mini docs, these puppies, and took a lot of work. But it's a record, and it's an archive record of Black artists who are also faculty and educators, arts educators, across the various departments of the College of Fine and Applied Arts. So it represents a unique record, archive, narrative of Black artists on this campus across all the disciplines. Which I found in writing this, I come out of a fine arts background, but in amassing a small library on Black arts, there are very few books who deal with books on Black arts and aesthetics, which deal with all of the disciplines, or most of the disciplines. The disciplines that I also deal with are life disciplines that Black folks develop as means of resilience and survival, medical disciplines, Africans develop what we now call vaccine, for instance, cooking, which we know Black folks do, in terms of as art, apparel, and sewing. Few people might know that Rosa Parks is a seamstress. In fact, she was coming home from a seamstress class the night that she was teaching young Black women sewing when she got stopped or refused to give up her seam on. So for me, and in the course, and in the e-text, because there's chapters which go all the way back to Africa, in which the question was posed with what must Black arts begin? And I said, and then I guess the prompt is, Black arts begins like humanity begins, the continent of Africa. And so, it has this long kind of millennial sweep in looking at how Africans, the African diaspora, Africans of America, in the Americas, because we go South America, we go to French-speaking folks, Negro to Afro-Latinx. And so it covers the range, or attempts to cover the range, of Black arts. The idea of arts as resilience as part of Black healing to racialized trauma is at the center of what we deal with, as well as, and it's kind of another center within a center, if you will, Black arts in terms of Black movements, because movements created by Black folks against racism and racialized trauma are often the inspiration of Black arts, whether it is spirituals, whether it is kind of work that we see in art and design. Certainly we know that one of the few, I would consider the only original art form to come from the United States is jazz. It's truly American, but jazz and blues as well. So it looks at again, the range of Black arts, but really centers the question of resilience and resistance in terms of subject matter and inspiration in Black arts.
Yeah, I would go, yeah, maybe, maybe you can go in that direction, because both Angela and Alice have very specific projects that they want to introduce. So, Liza, please introduce yourself and tell us about your work and something exciting that you're working on.
Okay. Yeah, it's, I guess I'll start by saying thank you, Sam, for having us here. It's just so nice to learn more about projects that I've known maybe from more of a distance, so thank you. I'm Liza Sylvestre, and this is Christopher Robert Jones, and I'm introducing both of us because we make up a project collectively together, which has been rather interesting to navigate. I mean, the university system that really values individualism. our project is Crip asterisk, Crip Epistemology in the Arts. And it's really an umbrella project that's made up of several smaller projects, some of which we can describe today. But the general idea is to, first of all, engage a generative approach to disability, and to do so from the final applied arts. Typically, disability studies, disability justice, are housed within the College of Applied Health Sciences and adapt a medical approach to these issues. And when you adapt a medical approach to disability, you always, there's always some residue of understanding disability as a lack, as something that is in need of fixing. And so a epistemological point of view, approaching it through the knowledge, the generative knowledge that is produced in and around the CRIP and disabled experience. Instead of that lineage of lack, it opens up a space of looking at that knowledge as positive or generative. And then obviously, we're in the College of Fine and Applied Arts. Our project is interestingly placed at the college level rather than within one of our college's units, which has been another one of those things that's a good thing, it's a good problem to have. but we use the arts rather than looking at disability as a way of problem solving. The arts allow us to think about the space that's created around disability and around epistemology. So it's a creative methodology, and we teach students, both non-disabled students and disabled students, how to think about their experiences in a generative way and to make points of connection between disability and non-disability so that everyone is included and responsible for access rather than just people who are disabled. And then should we maybe talk, I think your question was for us to talk maybe about something that's exciting, more specifically.
Yeah, that would be great if you talk about something exciting, but something that just popped in my mind after listening to you and listening to Lou, and I've been stumbling since you came to campus over my ignorance around CRIP work and CRIP theory. But we just had this sort of national circus around African-American studies in the AP curriculum. And so one question that people have been asking is, why should everyone study Black studies? And when you were talking, Liza, I thought first, when you mentioned students, we're talking about students with disabilities. And so then this question of why should everyone study CRIP theory? What's in it for letter, its meaning, where did it come from, why do you use it?
Yeah, well, just like you're saying, you know, the term crip is pejorative, has a long history of a kind of pejorative negative usage, and similar to the way that, you know, a term like queer sort of reclaimed and made malleable in service of something that is against stigma in some ways and towards a kind of expansion or like a gathering term. And so there's a number of kind of different and conflicting points of view about the use of that term. Still a lot of discussion and disagreement around it. But when we're using it, so there's many that use that term in that reclamation kind of way, and it's specifically around kind of cultural, social, political action. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what more we should say about it. Our use of crip, I guess, different from, or maybe in addition to that kind of reclamation of a pejorative word, has to do with crip theory, which was a theory developed by many people, but sort of popularized in a book by Robert McGrew in the mid-2000s, that basically attempted to create a theoretical theory project around how we understand disability in its intersections with maybe something specifically like sexuality or gender, but that a term like crip, much like way theorists have dealt with a term like queer, is about kind of pushing out and working against the ways that those cultural political formations have kind of continued to center specific points of view. If that makes sense. Does that answer your question?
Does that answer your question? Yes. Maybe a couple of nods. Yes? No? Someone else want to ask another question about that? You're shy. Please.
Oh, I do want to open. I feel like we should get back to others speaking. But I will add that the asterisk does open up that space of thinking about where the art project is called Crip Asterisk, which is sort of a challenging of previous definitions of crip and of disability studies. So the asterisk denotes something that's not there, that is not present. So thinking about the permeability of that term is also important to us.
So again, thinking about one of the reasons that I wanted to start with Lou and Liza and Christopher is I know Lou has this very deep, substantial movement background, has participated in a lot of movement work. And when I listen to you both, you three, it makes me think of a quote from Gil Scott-Heron, one of his songs, I can't remember what song, but in the song he says, first one wants freedom, then another wants freedom, then the whole damn world wants freedom. And I think we're sort of contending in some of that today is who are we willing to make room for, like on the planet. So, and in particular, Angela and Alex are working on relatively specific projects that in some way I think are the foundation of movement work supports those projects, but they're kind of specific work. I don't know that I would necessarily call them. I don't want to use the word equity, but Angela, would you like to talk a little bit about Champaign County African American Heritage Trail Project, please?
Sam, I would have gone with Gil Scott-Heron, Whitey on the Moon, but that's okay.
If you've heard of the African American Heritage Trail Project, raise your hand. Barb contacted me to see if I wanted to work with
different ways of being able to produce murals because, that are permanent enough, but yet also they can be able to be changed off this time. Now, back to the trail. Okay, one of the things that we, as we start looking at the trail, that, okay, this is not going to work. I'm not used to, sorry about that.
these projects that these people are sharing, it's reminding me that I'm working on another project as well that has a lot of intersections with these folks, and is also, I think, the reason that I got invited to be on this project that he and I are working on as well. So maybe I'll spend some time kind of talking about both. So our charge in this group that we are in is really to look at the community here and all the different definitions of community, all of the people that we can be connecting with, not only to just focus on growing audience for ourselves, but also as artists, as performing artists, what can we do to support the community? How can we use our art to help individuals and organizations? I'm hoping that we, you know, it's a new project, and so I'm hoping that we get to a point where we do have these conversations about audience engagement is also about not just you watching me as a performer, but me as a performer. How can I help you do something that you are interested in outside of my performance venue one day? And we began working together just at the end of last semester, so very fresh. And I know Sam is really excited about having conversations with a lot of people, so definitely find us if you're interested in knowing more about this and if you have ideas, because we're really in the brainstorming part of this project right now. And then I will go just briefly into my work, my art as a performance maker. I am currently working on this project that is very autobiographical, that is related to my identity as a Black person. It's called Stations of Black Loss. If any of you grew up Catholic, that might sound a little familiar to you. It is sort of a play on this idea of Stations of the Cross, which in Catholicism is the story of Jesus' crucifixion. I am not comparing myself to Jesus, I swear. As the project builds, it will make more sense as to why I'm borrowing from that title. But there are 14 Stations of the Cross. Stations of Black Loss has 14 stories. And these 14 stories are my stories of growing up as a Black person who hated being a Black person for the first 20 years of my life. And this journey that I have been going on to reclaim that identity for myself and to embrace that culture and learn more about it, because some of the ways in which I was introduced into the world I was introduced to when I was a child sort of kept me away from knowing about Black history and Black identity and Black culture. And I'll just use this time also to briefly plug, if you're around in March, I will be performing a piece, one of the 14 pieces from that series, that's actually called I'll Never Be Beyonce. And I'm going through Beyonce, it's a monologue with movement that goes through some of Beyonce's lyrics that are very pro-Black, and then I connect those lyrics to some stories in my life that are related but very anti-Black. And to me, this is the performance, the way that I sort of see these 14 pieces all coming together is actually through a larger performance installation that is audience interactive. A lot of my performance research does have to do with audience engagement, in that I like to make performances where the audience feels involved in the work, not just passive spectators of the work. And that also involves bringing my work to places that are considered non-traditional performance spaces, so that I have an opportunity to interact with people who might not choose to show up to a place like Krannert, because performance spaces have histories of excluding people, right? And even though Krannert and many all spaces now, I think, are working really hard to make sure that those histories are not continued, that it's a history that we can't ever forget and that people will not forget, right? And I am just thinking that this work that I'm creating for myself is obviously very healing for myself. I retell interactions that I had with people throughout my life that made me hate myself. And I hope that in hearing those stories, it makes all of us as audience members realize how complicit we all are in, specifically little Black girls either learning to love or hate themselves. The tiniest remarks that you might think are really insignificant are really huge sometimes. And so I'm kind of using this work as, again, for catharsis for myself, but also to just illuminate the types of things that marginalized folks hear on a daily basis, even sometimes from their own family members, that really contribute to these feelings of insecurity and self-hatred. And so that work, after all 14 pieces are created, again, will be sort of like an installation that I will engage audience members with. And if you're around the last weekend of March, we're going to be presenting a whole Department of Dance concert at the Virginia Theater. So you can find all that information on the Dance Department's website. This piece on Everybody Beyonce will be in that.
Well, thank you so much. We're right at 1 o'clock. That's not bad.
We're here.
That is not bad. You know, you said something about you were talking about coming to term with being a Black girl, being a Black woman as an individual. And I think, in some ways, I think back to Baldwin's sort of analysis about us as a nation coming to terms with who we are as a family and hating our own Blackness in our family, or hating our own difference or crippedness in our family, or our own queerness in our family. That was actually, for me, that was a pretty amazing connection between what happens at the individual level and also what happens at the national level. And Angela's work is sort of, in some ways, Angela's work, Liza and Christopher's, is about a restoration of our own presence. Like, this is who we are, right? Like this is who we are. And we struggle with embracing and accepting and knowing that. I think maybe we'll take 1 minute if there's one question. Yes.
Yeah, because I got to bounce. I got another meeting to go to. I don't need that. Thank you. Just a PSA.
Actually, you do.
Public address announcement. The Black Arts course that I created, like Angela's, started with the murder of George Floyd. We, in the whole course, we look at all the art created around the world memorializing George Floyd. There's public art all over. In fact, one of the best pieces is a video that we use in northern Syria, in a bombed out building where this artist, Syrian artist, has this mural of George Floyd. It's the very place that suffered the earthquake recently. We end, and we just put it in the course, because in e-text you can add all kinds of materials as you go. We did Tyree Nichols. And if you haven't looked at his website for his photography in Memphis, that artwork, you should do it. So if you look at George Floyd and the art created about his murder, Tyree Nichols and the art he created, then you'll see the significance of the loss of white supremacy, of weaponizing, that's the word that the idiots in Congress are using, the weaponization of white supremacy, and the art that comes out of that. Sorry, I got it down.
Well, thank you so much. Maybe we can get the Y to agree